contribution will present a synthesis of pre-Columbian paleofacialism in a diachronic perspective from 5000 before our era to 1500 of our era. We will examine the interrelationship of exploitation according to the size of 8 fish families, and we start by asking a question: does fish body size differ across the islands of the Lesser Antilles and across time? And two most informative research questions should be asked of archaeological sites. The first one: is there evidence in the archaeological record for change in natural resource, and how far back in time does it extend? And what are the drivers for such a change, be they natural or anthropogenic? Because all archaeological sites represent some level of anthropogenesis set within the environment, it is difficult to tease apart competing hypotheses associated with natural or anthropogenic trends encountered in the biological data. Thousands of hundreds of remains of vertebrates were recovered in the last 20 years in the Caribbean. Zooarchaeology is the study of animal remains excavated from archaeological sites, and we have tools for that to evaluate the interaction between human and environment. First, from the middle, we do excavation and we sieve the sediment in order to keep the bones in a 1 to 2 millimeter screen mesh. Then in laboratory, we do the sorting by class of animal and skeletal parts, and we proceed to the identification at the lowest level as possible, at the level of the species, the family, the genus, depending on the difficulty of the bone. That gives information about the targeted species. After, we look at the trace, and we look the type of consumption, the transformation of the bones, and we have traces of butchery, fire, drill, suspendance. And from the fish size estimation, we can estimate the ecosystems and the fishing techniques. Then we did that in the Caribbean, and this is a big basin with a lot of islands. For the moment, 24 islands were explored. And because we start like this, we ask a question. Over the course of the past 40 years, 3 key scientific advances have led to the hypothesis that pre-Columbian anthropogenic change took place on the islands of the Caribbean as Native American populated the region. Our ability to ask and answer the question in a new and different way is based on 3 major scientific advancements. The first one is the MacArthur and Wilson theory of island. However, MacArthur and Wilson, in their original research, did not consider pre-Hispanic anthropogenesis as an external forcing mechanism of environmental change. The second one is the scientific advance about the quantitative models that ranks aquatic organisms on a trophic level from 1 to 5 in the marine food web. Pauli and his colleagues charted the trophic level of forward fishery landing cover time from the 50s to discover a decline in the mean trophic level of 4 of the world fisheries. They refer to this 45-year statistical trend as fishing down marine food web. And their research has served as a modern baseline of the slow degradation of our wild fisheries resource under industrial fishing practice. Without ecological baseline, there is no benchmark for ecologists trying to restore ecological equilibrium. Then they are very important. However, some researchers assume that low-level pre-industrial subsistence fishing could not significantly influence marine ecosystems. But is this true? The third point is Elizabeth Wing and Steve Wing, and later their colleagues, have taken the third step in evaluating this ancient baseline under the principle of the two first ones. And they went to study six different islands in the Antilles, representing early and late ceramic age deposits. Then, just to show you very quickly who were these pre-Columbian, the first human settlement chronology started 1000 BC, and this Amerindian population came from South and Central America. They were nomads in the sea, and they moved from island to island according to their economic and social trend. From 500 BC, started the migration of farmer porters from Venezuela with the ceramics, and they were sedentary community organized in village, and they display a certain cultural homogeneity throughout the archipelago. Around 900 after Christ, there was a phenomenon of regionalization of the island society with a multiplication of cultures. They had organized a network of village and specialized satellite sites, even the smallest island. And Columbus discovered the Greater Antilles populated by the Taino Indians and met the Kalinagos or Carib Indians in the Lesser Antilles. This was the period of contact. So we went to analyzing the zooarchaeological data from 12 islands, and from Anguilla in the north to La Martinique in the south. And from now we have a corpus of 131 assemblage and a lot of remains that we can work at a statistical level. We have 1.2 million of remains of fish. The vertebrate taxa fished and hunted by the pre-Columbians are very diversified, with 434 species identified to date, mainly teleost fish with 214 taxa. To help the identification and osteological collection of the Atlantic fauna, FAO 31 has been constituted since 1994 and it's deposited at the lab ASCA. It includes almost 900 species and a little bit more than 900 specimens. And now the first results, we can see that the evolution of the vertebrate to the time, we can see a variation between the terrestrial and marine vertebrates. The terrestrial are the amphibians, squamates, birds, and mammals. And the marine species are fish, turtles, birds, and marine mammals. And they are reversed through the time. During the Pleistocene and Holocene, the terrestrial species dominate, and in the Archaic Age too. During the early Ceramic Age, even if the tetrapods are dominant, we have a lot of the more and more fish. And those fish are especially tuna. During the late Ceramic Age, the corallian and mangrove fish became predominant. And during the colonial time, the mammals from the old continent became dominant in the fauna remains. We have a complete change of the vertebrate diet through the time. The how to reconstruct the archaeological ecosystem in this case, but of course we use fish baths. And we can estimate the proportion of each ecosystem according to the number of individuals of each species identified in the samples. Indeed, many coral reef fish exhibit an habitat partitioning throughout their lifetime as ontogenic shifters. They start at juveniles in mangrove and then they switch to the corallian reef when they are adults. That this is very important because we need to measure them to be sure to find the good location where they were fished. Then reconstructing this ecology of each species, we estimated the proportion for each island. And here we can see that there is a major dichotomy between the volcanic island from the inner arch of the Lesser Antilles and the corallian islands. the Corallian islands are have a predisposition to the Corallian and sandy bottom fishing, and the fishing seems more specialized. But in the volcanic one, they have more rocky reef and deep water, then so they have more pelagic fish. Then we did the osteometry on 8 families. For that, we took the we previously established the regression relationship using modern specimens for the most common fish species, genera and families in the Lesser Antilles. The measurements were correlated with the size, length, total length, standard length, and the mass of the fish. At the end, we have something like 2,000 equations that were calculated to estimate this fish measurements. Then, the allometric equation established between these measurements, size, weight, and bones, were used to estimate the size of the archaeological individuals. The results are presented as a diagram for each species of fish. During the Archaic Age and at the beginning of the Ancient Ceramic Age, the Emulidae were fished essentially between 20 and 60 cm long, standard length. From the end of the Ancient Ceramic Age, the size was less than 20 cm long. Gradually, the size of the fish decreased until they reached an average of 15 cm length. At the same time, there was a change in the ecosystem expected for the fishing. The coral environment dominated more and more, and at the beginning of the recent Ceramic Age, and then it changed at the end of the Ceramic Age, and then the mangrove became dominant. And if we add all the species, all the families that I showed you previously, it shows a global fishery during the time. This trend of decreasing fish is found in several species and even entire families. If we accumulate the size curve of all species, we can see a gradual decrease since the end of the Ancient Ceramic Age. A shift in technology where there is an decrease in the relative abundance of pelagic species, such as tuna, to corallian and mangrove species. Substantially, watercraft would have been needed to travel and to more dangerous offshore habitats. About 50 species were collected during the colonial age, the colonial period in the site. These are mainly small ones from coral, lagoons, and mangrove. However, very few pelagic species, such as the very largest euphoridae illustrated here, have been identified. If we apply the trophic level model to the archaeological site, the mean trophic level declines between the early and late assemblage. In some sites, this accompanies an increased emphasis on taxa with large population, such as earrings, for example. Then we must ask, do these assemblages represent the Polly and our colleagues fishing down marine food web? It's a question, but also we could ask, this pattern could also result from climatic change. During our 2,000-year window, local and worldwide climate events would not have been uniform. So each of the sites represents a time series of human environmental interaction unique to each geographic locality and environmental condition. Then we can ask also if this pattern could result from cultural change, such as technological innovation. Across space and time, there would have been asynchronous cultural practices that would not have resulted in a uniform pattern of fishing down marine food webs. If we look carefully at that, we can see that there is a synchronous cultural economy change everywhere in the Lesser Antilles. We can see in the economical part that they were fishing with risk for capturing quickly, but very big fish. And instead, versus the later in the time, the fishing techniques were without risk, and anybody could do it, children or people. But the time consuming is important, and it's more and more small fish. In the same times, there is a change of location of the sites. We were mostly in volcanic sites, and we changed to the coral island, sandy bays, and mangrove. Then we have an hypothesis to be verified in the future, in the increasing specialized economy choice has determined the new location of the village and the fishing. Human exposure, the common trait is a human exposure time with island ecosystems that are small, fragile, biological reservoirs. Ecological equilibrium is easily changing and difficult to result. Not taking into account the fossil data probably contributes to a significant underestimation of the impact of man on marine biodiversity, particularly the Caribbean. And all the humans are the keystone species, or can leave an imprint on the environment regardless of the level of cultural complexity. It is not the level of cultural complexity that results in human environmental impact, but the way the environment is used. And I thank you for your attention.